Good afternoon, YouTube. It's been a little over 2 years since the tankless water heater was installed, and I've had a number of questions and comments on the various videos I made of the installation. I tried to answer most of those in the comments section or in emails, so I thought I'd make this video to share some of those answers in a single video here. About 2 years ago, I made a video where I described the selection process I went through to pick this particular model, and this is a Takagi tankless water heater, so it runs on natural gas. So the two main features that I liked about this heater, one is it could operate off of half-inch gas line, and then the other feature I liked is that it could use PVC or plastic venting. So just to summarize the project a little bit, right in here used to be a 40-gallon tank type water heater that was installed when the house was built back in the mid-50s. So the idea was get rid of the heater that was here, install a tankless heater over here, and then in the space occupied by the tank heater, put in a utility sink. Anyway, that was the rough plan, and the goals were to reuse as much of the infrastructure that exists right in this location for this heater and then also the utility sink. So to start off, there were 6 items that this heater had to connect to. One was the wall, then I had to connect to the gas for the fuel, I had to connect to the water, I needed to connect to the condensate drain, and I also needed some electricity to run the heater. And then the 6th item was I needed some way to vent the exhaust out of the house. What I did was I prioritized those 6 things in decreasing order of difficulty. So difficulty meant how difficult was it going to be to adapt the heater to the existing infrastructure. I put the gas at the highest priority, and then I put mounting the heater to the wall 2nd. I put the venting 3rd, and then the water connections, then the condensate drain, and then the last one was the electrical connections. So here's the gas pipe came out of the wall. Like I said, this heater is rated to operate off of half-inch gas pipe, and it has a half-inch pipe nipple sticking out right there. I chose to use 3/4-inch pipe to connect to it, and that was based on one main reason. So underneath the house where this pipe comes up through the wall, there's about 12 feet of half-inch gas pipe already there under the house, and that would be rather difficult to change, so that's why I wanted a heater that would work on half-inch gas pipe. And looking up in the gas flow tables, at 120,000 BTU, which is what this heater runs, 120 cubic feet per hour of gas, I can have anywhere from 10 to 15 feet of half-inch pipe. I already had 12 feet, and to come out of the wall and up to the heater, I needed another 3 feet of pipe. So I could have run half-inch pipe all the way up, and that probably would have worked. The more conservative decision was to go with 3/4-inch rigid pipe. So it's a little more expensive, maybe 1/3 more cost to buy a 3/4-inch pipe or fitting than a half-inch fitting. So the idea was pay a little more up front for the 3/4-inch pipe and fittings and have a much better chance than trying to save a little money with half-inch pipe and then find out you had problems and then have to replace it, because that would be a major hassle to have to replace all this pipe once everything was connected. And that's also the reason I didn't use the corrugated stainless steel tubing, because that, even though it's 3/4 outside dimension, the inside is closer to half-inch rigid pipe. So the decision was made to use 3/4-inch rigid pipe, and that gives you the biggest inside diameter and also the smoothest inside diameter, and that will give you the maximum flow. And there's been no problem with flow, even at maximum output, no problem with low gas pressure or anything. However, using rigid pipe means there's no adjustment in the gas. It's there. So the idea was drop the heater on top of the gas pipe, and that's where the heater goes. So that's why I put locating or mounting the heater on the wall second. And one problem that brings up is that you can't ensure that the heater screws into wall studs because you can't move the heater once the pipe is there. To deal with that, I put this plywood on the wall, screwed the plywood into the wall studs, and then screwed the heater into the plywood. And then I was able to get two screws. You can probably see there's a screw and a washer right there on the bottom. There's also one on the top that go into a wall studs. Then number three was the venting. So one thing I did to make the venting a little bit easier to line up there is when I put in the gas pipe, I angled the pipe so it came out to the left and up, which moved the heater over, and that made the venting easier to line up. So speaking of venting, that was another hot question area. One commenter said, you can't use PVC venting on a tankless heater because I installed a tankless heater in my house and it has to use stainless steel venting. And yes, your heater probably needs stainless steel venting. There's two types of tankless heaters. You've got the non-condensing heaters, and then you've got the condensing heaters. The non-condensing or mid-efficiency heaters have hot exhaust gas that goes up well over the boiling point of water, maybe 300 Fahrenheit, 140 C. So you've got very hot gas going up the exhaust. So in a non-condensing heater, you want to get the exhaust out of the unit before the water vapor condenses out of the exhaust. That's why they're called non-condensing. And they require metallic venting because it's hot. And they require stainless steel because if the exhaust does condense inside of the pipe, it will corrode things like galvanized, so that's why you need stainless pipe. This is a condensing heater. There's two heat exchangers inside. Primary one is what heats the water up, but the secondary heat exchanger extracts the heat out of the exhaust. The water condenses, you know, the water vapor, and that releases additional heat to preheat the water before it goes into the burner heat exchanger. So this heater is about 93% efficient compared to 83% for a non-condensing heater. So a couple other questions I had on the venting. I did have a little bit of trouble finding some of these fittings in 3-inch PVC. So one question was, why didn't I use 2-inch PVC? And the other question was, why I didn't use something like ABS, which would be much easier to find in this size. That's a very common ABS pipe size. And as I found out, it's not quite as common in PVC. So I had already had everything except for a few fittings. And then I found the difficulty. In hindsight, it probably would have been much easier to do the venting in ABS, which is a suitable material. And the other reason was all of the literature, the web page, the brochures, the installation manual, all the videos you look at on YouTube, all the web page articles, they all say PVC, 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 the heater comes with PVC adapters. And at that point, all you think of is PVC. I guess I never went back and reevaluated if I should use some of the other materials. And those other materials, you can use PVC, CPVC, ABS, or polypropylene. ABS would be a little bit easier to source. PVC, you know, the heater came with PVC fittings, and one commenter asked why I didn't use 2-inch. And two reasons. One is I already had all the 3-inch stuff, and then the existing ceiling penetration and the roof penetration were for a 3-inch flue from the old heater. If I use 2-inch, I'd have to plug up those holes. For the water, I decided to use flexible stainless steel tubing there. But the thinking was use the flexible because if I ever had to change this heater out and maybe in 10 years I can't get the exact same model and maybe the water hoses are in a slightly different position, I should be able to handle that. And the gas, I can just move it in or out to shift the position of the gas pipe. So that would be easy to deal with. So water was pretty straightforward. Just hook up two hoses. And then as far as the condensate drain, there's the stand pipe for the clothes washer right there. There's the output of the drain. That was just straight shot down. The clear PVC tubing that I use seems to be adequate. It flows condensate. It hasn't degraded. It hasn't plugged up. That works fine. And then the electric, I had a plug in the wall right there for the clothes washer. Just had to swap that out for a GFCI receptacle. And right now I'm actually running the tankless on my solar AC power inverter. So yeah, that pretty much covers all of the connection aspects. So some other questions I had were, well, why didn't I just run the venting straight through the wall and right outside? Well, if I did that, my kitchen is on the back side of this wall and the vent would come out in my kitchen cabinets. If I were to come down here, there's a porch roof you can probably see out there, so you can't have the vent under a porch. So yeah, I could move the heater about 15 feet down the wall and make the venting really easy, just out the wall, and that would be it. But then I'd have to run gas, water, drainage, electric 15 feet down the wall because all of that stuff is right here. That's why I put gas as number one. I have to hook up to the gas. There's not a lot of wiggle room on the gas. It was at about the maximum limit that I could get away with on the gas pipe distance without having to run a new gas line under the house. So if you have a tank type heater like in a garage such as I have here, if you can get rid of that tank heater, put a utility sink here. So you can see here, here's the utility sink, here's the drain, here's the water. It's a no-brainer to put the sink here, the water heater here. And as you've seen in the two flush videos that I've done, flushing the water heater is trivial. You just throw a bucket in the sink, put your pump in it, put your chemicals in it. You hook the hoses up here, you turn on the pump, you turn off the pump, and you're done. You know, you don't even make a mess. So that's been a really killer combination, is having the heater here, the utility sink right next to it. All of this was possible because you got rid of the big 40-gallon tank that used to sit here. Having this much extra space, you've got about 10 square feet of space that was recovered and has gone to a very useful utility sink. But yeah, hopefully that answers all the questions about installing the tankless, why things were done in particular order. So if you have any other questions, post up in the comment section down below, and I'll put some of the other installation videos over here on the left side. And as always, thanks for watching.